You know them, you love them, we got them. Western Carolina's classic rock station, Power 90.5.
Are you ready for some football? It's the biggest game of the year, the Super Bowl. And we'll be covering that and other various sports ball conspiracies. Stay right where you're at. Don't touch that dial. It's time for the craziest show in the mountains. Live from the campus of Western Carolina University in Cullowhee, it's time for the craziest show in the mountains. I'm talking on other than Manny's Rockin Conspiracies here on WWCU-FM, heard throughout Silva, Cullowhee, Cashers, all throughout Jackson and Haywood counties, and worldwide on WWCUFM.com. I'm your host, Manny and Frenzy. Please just call me Manny. Welcome again to the craziest show in the mountains on this beautiful February 3rd, 2019. As said earlier, it is Super Bowl Sunday. The Los Angeles Rams take on the New England Patriots. It looks to be a very, very interesting contest. Do I have any predictions? I don't. But, as you might expect, I have a conspiracy. I do. So let's explain. Let's take a little step back to the NFC Championship game. It's the New Orleans Saints against the Los Angeles Rams. 3rd and 10 with 1:45 to go in the fourth quarter at the beautiful Louisiana Superdome. Drew Brees throws a pass towards Tommy Lee Lewis. The Rams cornerback nickel Robbie Coleman made a nearly helmet-to-helmet contact. Should have been a pass interference call. The referees thought it was tipped and did not call pass interference. Eventually, in overtime, the Los Angeles Rams went on to win the game on a last-second field goal in OT. Rams fans and the Rams management have not taken the loss very well. Very well at all. The NFL later admitted that they blew the call. Simple enough, right? No. Saints fans are very unhappy over it, making billboards around Atlanta, where the Super Bowl is this year, about how they got messed up. The fix was in, as they might say. This led to, however, legitimate conspiracy theories about the game. And if my computer wasn't so slow today, I have no idea why it's acting like this. It's been like this all morning. I'm going to have to find it. Super Bowl. Well, I'm looking up that story because it's on my phone because my computer's not working. I'd like to point out Western Carolina University graduate Keon Crossan of the New England Patriots will be playing in this year's Super Bowl. I'm actually very excited for Keon. I had a class with him, and he was just one of the best people I've met in my life, and I'm so happy for the guy. I'm sure he's going to do well if he gets to play in the Super Bowl. So, here we go. From SB Nation. Attention, conspiracy theorists. The NFL is totally picking refs to help the Rams win Super Bowl 53. The joke article by Adam Stites, submitted on February 1st, 2019. This is from ESPN. There is some concern in league circles about the NFL's judgment in allowing four game officials who live in Southern California to work the game between the Los Angeles Rams and the New Orleans Saints, league sources told ESPN. Those same four officials, all with long ties to Southern California, were the ones most responsible for the non-call on Rams cornerback nickel Robbie Coleman's early helmet-to-helmet hit on Saints wide receiver Tommy Lee Lewis that was widely viewed as pass interference. The referee in that game, Bill Vinovich, lives in Southern California and graduated from the University of San Diego. So Rams running back Todd Gurley had to tip his cap to a fellow California for helping out. But certainly after a firestorm of criticism for its officiating, the NFL will be more careful about choosing its officials for the Super Bowl, right? Wrong. Now, Basically, the writer of this article goes on to make a joke conspiracy that John Perry, who will head the officiating crew for this year's Super Bowl, in games that he has refereed for the Saints whenever they were in St. Louis, or in their current incarnation in Los Angeles, that they are 7-0. Here's how he ends it with. Do I actually believe anything I just wrote? No. But it's much more fun for Saints fans to blame a conspiracy theory for the Rams winning the NFC Championship than to admit they blew it down the stretch. Now the Patriots also have a prepackaged conspiracy theory already cooked up in the Super Bowl 53 if they happen to lose. It's very interesting. I doubt that there's any conspiracy. You know, teams just get bad calls every now and then. In 2001, there was the tuck rule between the Patriots and the Raiders. There was last year, fellow Steelers fans know this very well, the call on Jesse James' touchdown against the Patriots last season. There have been several non-calls. Teams just have had bad calls in their past. It's how it is. You can't try and change the victory and try and think of a conspiracy theory as to how the New Orleans Saints didn't get to the Super Bowl. You just can't do that. The team was terrible down the stretch. You just can't do that. But what do you think? Do you think the NFL purposely put the Rams in the Super Bowl and they fixed the game? Do you think that? Why don't you let me know at 828-227-7173. Again, 828-227-7173. It's a big show planned tonight. There was a UFO sighting in Greensboro, North Carolina. And I also got a lot of things like Homer baseball player Jose Canseco had a lot of conspiracy theories. One about this game where he said he traveled into the future and that the Rams win the Super Bowl. There, Russia reopens the investigation to Dyatlov Pass incident. And there's conspiracies about the Titanic sinking. Very, very interesting. Very interesting. Again, why don't you let me know if you think the Saints game was fixed at 828-227-7173. 828-227-7173. All right, let's get back. Let's get started with some music. I have Aerials from System of a Down. You're listening to Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies on WWCUFM Power 90.5. Welcome back to Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies here on WWCUFM Cullowhee. That was a sweet victory by David Glenn Isley and best known for its appearance on the SpongeBob episode Band Geeks. Today, or actually tonight, it just might get played. And my sources are correct. It's going to get played during the halftime show. It's going to happen. See, Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies did it first. Now the NFL's doing it. Yes, yes, yes. My computer's having issues again. So I'm having to pull up most of it on my phone, trying to get it to work. Don't know what's really happening with my laptop. Excuse the interruption. But here's something that came out of our neck of the woods here in North Carolina, a little bit further out in Greensboro. From the Charlotte Observer. They can get it to pull up. So now it wants to pull up. Strange pill-shaped object seen pulsing in North Carolina sky ignites UFO debate. What was it? YouTube user Space Brett says he was trying to film birds when he noticed, quote, noticed a strange flashing light in the sky near an airplane. He thought he'd missed recording, but it later saw footage with an object that was pill-shaped with bullet-headed ends. Video of a random flashing object in the sky outside Greensboro, North Carolina, has ignited an ongoing debate on social media, including claims others have seen the same mystery object. In the 5-minute video, which is magnified and slowed down, the pill-shaped object is seen soaring through the sky and producing a series of flashes. The video was posted Saturday and has been viewed thousands of times since being picked up by YouTube channels devoted to UFOs and unsolved mysteries, including Hidden Underbelly 2.0. It's credited to Brett Jones, known as Space Brett on YouTube, who explained that the weird thing was spotted Friday, January 25th, while he was trying to film birds outside Greensboro. This is from Jones himself. I noticed a strange flashing light in the sky near an airplane. It was moving slowly in the sky, a little slower than the planes flying around. I did not think I captured it at all, because the focus would only hunt and not lock on. However, he says he later magnified the footage by 900% and slowed it down to reveal a glinting pill-shaped object that produces flash from its two ends. When I saw it, it just blew me away because it was not what I expected at all. I don't know what that is. At least one person, it's nothing more than a Mylar balloon with a string or a Wi-Fi extender antenna balloon, in part because it looks like the object might have a tether. However, Jones says that wouldn't explain the flashing and vanishing, and the suspected tether could also be the object ejecting some kind of fuel. Here are some comments. Quote, I clearly know the difference between planes, satellites, iridium flares, meteorites, helicopter, etc. This is different. It seems to flash incredibly bright with no pattern, even fades out into a dull red light occasionally. North Carolina has seen the scene of reported UFO sightings for decades, though some have later been explained away as commercial blimps or military aircraft. I mean, North Carolina is home to Fort Bragg, which is where my father is stationed at. So I could see the military part of it. Is North Carolina starting to be a... is it starting to be a UFO hotspot? If so, if there is any alien or extraterrestrial, I think is the better term, that is probably listening to this broadcast, can you come to Cullowhee or Silva or anywhere in Jackson or Haywood counties? That would be amazing. I would love that. Wouldn't you? Why don't you let me know at 828-227-7173. Again, 828-227-7173. Let's get back to the music. This is You Spin Me Right Round by Dope. It'll be followed by Godzilla by the Blue Oyster Cult. You're listening to Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies on WWCUFM Cullowhee Power 90.5.
Y'all get the guns, the drugs. From my generation, I'll take the fall. The state across the nation, and it's a sin. The guns, the fake, the fraud, they're messing with me. Come on, come on, come on, let's get it out.
Move to the music, play that.
Welcome back to Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies here on WWCU Cullowhee, the broadcast service of Western Carolina University, Power 90.5. It's Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies once again. And you never know what's going to happen between when I do the show last week and this week. You never know what's going to happen, all right? This is one that interests me. It's about a man by the name of Jose Canseco. Jose Canseco was a baseball player, played for various teams, including the Oakland A's and the New York Yankees. He hit about 400 home runs. Very good baseball player. He started tweeting some very, very odd stuff about time travel. And let me just give you an idea. It sort of all started on the 1st of January. Let me find it real quick. Invest in space travel. Which, okay, fine. That's a call to action. If we colonize the moon, I should be president. Are we still in debt if we print our own money? These are all committed, but it gets even more interesting on January 30th. Quote, we are in communication with aliens with a very flexible body composition called the AI-51. In our tweet, these aliens are going to teach us how to try and travel. The brain can physically travel without the body. Aliens have been trying to teach us how to time travel. But first, we have to change our body composition, which we are not willing to do. We have tried with animals and it has failed. Time travel puts 42,651 pounds of pressure on a human skeletal structure. Can you detach the brain from the body and equalize the pressure? It could be done. There's more. Our science is totally irrelevant to aliens. And by then you think, what is he talking about? I don't know either. I'm at a loss for words on this one as well. And you think that might be it, but instead, he tweeted this out 6 hours ago. I just time traveled into the future. Rams win 27-20, which is his Super Bowl prediction for the Super Bowl today between the Los Angeles Rams and the New England Patriots. In the words of a certain person on YouTube, I have several questions. Time travel puts 42,651 pounds of pressure on a human skeletal structure? What? I don't even understand how that works. Or what he's saying. You're like, what in the world are you saying, Jose Canseco? I don't even know. It also brings me something else that I tweeted out on my Twitter account at Manny Radio Derg. I tweeted this out. I quote, I think the FBI is coming after me. Robert Mueller must have put me on some list because why else would this network come up? And it's a picture of our list of networks that I can connect to. And one of them was called FBI Van. I don't know what this is about. I don't know if I did anything wrong or if I'm considered some Russian agent or something. I don't know. I mean, I can speak some Russian. Does that mean that I'm some, of course, I'm willing to bet it's just a joke that someone made their network FBI van. But you know, anything is possible in this world. Anything is possible, my good friends. Anything. Did I say anything? Anything. It's a very, very, very odd sort of set of standards. Well, I mentioned the Super Bowl. You are welcome to call in with any predictions that you have at 828-227-7173. Keep me company because it's just me in here until CB Roy gets in. CB Roy is Mostly Blues from 8 p.m. to 1 a.m. here on WWCU-FM, Cullowhee. It's a nice show to relax from all these conspiracies and maybe also enjoy the game with some nice blues. All right, let's get back to music with some Led Zeppelin. That's right, we're playing some classic rock on here. Isn't that a twist? I do a show with no hat on, and now I'm playing Led Zeppelin. Why not? You're listening to Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies on WWCU Cullowhee Power 90.5. It's the 7 o'clock Numa Numa here on Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies. It's 7 o'clock. One more hour until CB Roy is Mostly Blues. And as I was off the air, I can't English right now. What's going on? And during all this, the Super Bowl has started. I'll give you a nice, good update. The last play was Jared Goff of the LA Rams made a short pass to Rodney Woods to New England 42 for 7 yards. It is currently 0-0 between the Patriots and the Rams. As far as I know, Keon Crossan has not recorded any statistics yet. Tom Brady threw an interception to start the game. So already it looks to be a very, very interesting... Excuse me, Robert Woods got that pass. It looks to be a very interesting game already. Very, very interesting. But I want to get into something that I found that I just could not believe. This comes from history.com. It's about the Titanic. Now, if you don't know what the Titanic is, I'll give a basic idea. The RMS Titanic, or Royal Maiden Ship Titanic, was a ship that was built by White Star Line as part of its Olympic class. The Olympic class was designed to be very large, but very luxurious. They were in heavy competition with their company, Cunard Line. Very heavy competition. It was built by Harland and Wolff in Belfast, Ireland. It was a massive ship. And in the early hours of April 15th, 1912, on its voyage from Southampton to New York City, the ship struck an iceberg and over the course of an hour sank into the Atlantic Ocean where she resides today. More than 1,500 died, making it one of the most deadliest commercial peacetime maritime disasters in modern history. It was the largest ship afloat, and it was her first voyage when she sank. They made a movie about it, which there may be a conspiracy about that, but there are actually, I was surprised to find this out, there are several conspiracy theories about the RMS Titanic. Let's look into them from history.com. Late in the evening on April 14th, I'm going to say April 14th, what? The RMS Titanic hit an iceberg and sank into the icy waters of the North Atlantic, killing 1,500 to 2,000 passengers and crew members aboard. To make sense of this tragic and seemingly random disaster, people over the past century have told stories of ominous signs of bad luck that were supposedly ignored beforehand, or spun elaborate conspiracy theories to explain the real reason it sank. The first one is that J.P. Morgan, the millionaire banker at the time, had planned the disaster to end his rivals, because some of his rivals, Jacob Astor, Isidore Strauss, and Benjamin Guggenheim, all millionaires, all perished aboard the Titanic. The theory hinged on the fact that Morgan had originally planned to sail on the Titanic, but changed his mind shortly after it before it took off. Yet it doesn't offer any explanation for how he caused the ship to hit an iceberg and kill over 1,500 people, let alone the three men he supposedly intended to die. To top it off, the theory claims Morgan threatened to kill them because they opposed the Federal Reserve, even though Astor and Guggenheim don't appear to have taken a position on it, and Strauss actually supported it. So that's one conspiracy. Don't think it really holds up. Oh, there's more to it. Alternative versions of this theory claim that the Rothschild banking family or the Jesuits were the ones who arranged Astor, Strauss, and Guggenheim's deaths on the Titanic. Hold on, what? The Jesuits. The Jesuits. What? As the Washington Post notes, invoking the Rothschilds as international conspirators is a centuries-old anti-Semitic trope. The Rothschild family founded banking houses across Europe in the 1800s, and they have been a favorite target of conspiracy theorists ever since. And this theory resurfaced in connection with QAnon, which I've covered on this show before. Here's another conspiracy about the Titanic, that it never sank. You heard that one, that it never sank. People seem to love a good insurance fraud story, so maybe it's unsurprising that this conspiracy theory is one of Titanic's most popular. This one posits that someone switched the Titanic with another White Star Line ship, the RMS Olympic. But as Paul Burns, vice president and curator for the Titanic Museum attractions in Missouri and Tennessee, points out, it just doesn't make any sense. And the theory goes that the Olympic was damaged, sailing to Southampton, New York in 1911, and went back to Belfast, Ireland for repairs. And I don't get it. It's an odd one. It claims that some person or people found that the Olympic that too severely damaged to be profitable, so at some point switched it with Titanic to purposefully ditch the damaged ship, reap the insurance money, and it seems kill a bunch of people in the process. This is similar to, I think I mentioned this on the radio last week, there was this 9/11 hacker group, and they claimed that because the owner of the World Trade Center opened a insurance policy that covered terrorist attacks, that it means that 9/11 was an inside job. I'm not going to talk on that theory, but think about it what you will. Here's another one. A mummy's curse doomed the Titanic. One of the pastors who went down the Titanic was William Steed, a British editor who subscribed to early 20th century spiritualism and had spent the past several years claiming a cursed mummy was causing a mysterious destruction and disaster in London. As with other myths about Egyptian curses, this myth played off of colonialist anxiety about the people whose land they had plundered. On board the Titanic, Steed happily repeated his tale of the mummy's curse to other pastors. After the ship sank, a survivor recounted Steed's story to the New York World, and the media picked it up. The next month, the Washington Post ran this headline: Ghost of the Titanic, Vengeance of Hoodoo Mummy, followed man who wrote its story. Burns, why does this ad keep popping up, says some people link the mummy's curse to Egyptian artifacts that survivor and hero Margaret Brown really did take with her on the Titanic to deliver to a museum in Denver. In other versions of the story, the mummy was actually aboard the Titanic because the British Museum had sold it to an American who was shipping it home, Snopes reports. Think of that what we will. And the last one that we'll cover, I think some of you know of the movie Titanic by James Cameron in 1997. It's about Rose, a woman who is from a very, very wealthy family, who's in an arranged marriage to someone she doesn't like, and she meets this artist named Jack on the Titanic. It's a very great movie. But there is a conspiracy theory that Jack Dawson from the Titanic is actually Jay Gatsby in The Great Gatsby. The one coincidence with all this is that both characters are played by Leonardo DiCaprio. Here's how it works. The movie is obviously an alternate timeline where he survived the sinking of the ship and went on to build a life for himself. Ship, I should say, actually. I didn't say any words, but went on to build a life for himself in America in an attempt to reunite with Rose, writes Chris Loft on Tor.com, a science fiction and fantasy site. He survives, builds himself into a party-going showman in the jazz age and hopes that Rose will one day appear, but ends up finding love with another woman, Daisy. I'll leave that one up to you. Let's get back to the music. This is The Devil and I by Slipknot. You're listening to Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies on WWCU-FM, the broadcast service of Western Carolina University, Power 90.5. Welcome back to Manny's Rockin' Conspiracies here on WWCU Cullowhee. I want to give one more Super Bowl update before I sign off. With 16 seconds left in the second quarter, it looks to be a Patriot lead by a field goal 3-0 over the Los Angeles Rams. My friend texted me this. I think it's just funny, goofy enough to say, I wish you could have told Keon that he hopes he had to have a sweet victory for tonight's Super Bowl. Thank you all for tuning in to Manny Rockin' Conspiracy, especially a new listener, MOB, over the pond in the UK. Thank you so much for tuning in to the craziest show in the mountains. This has been Manny's Rockin' Conspiracy. To keep up the show, you should follow me on Twitter at Manny Radio Dirk, on Instagram under the same name, and on Facebook. Give it a like at facebook.com/Manny Rockin'. I'm your host, Manny and Frenzy. Until the next time we meet here on WWCU, word up. Enjoy the game. The
outfit, she's a little more grandpa. Hot belly gobbling, wobbling now, chasing after your mama. Ah, let's go give it to ya, subscribe for more. This is the motherfucking info war. We love our Muslims, the poets, oh, they're so sweet.